take me there. Video, we're going to talk about one of the greatest dangers to outdoor workers, and really to anybody who goes outdoors, tick-borne diseases. It gets overlooked. A lot of it's pretty commonsensical. And sometimes as safety professionals, we get so high and mighty that we overlook the commonsensical hazards and dangers in our workplaces. And one of those commonsensical hazards, especially outdoor workers, construction, forestry, agriculture, other outdoor occupations, one of the greatest dangers is being bitten by a tick that's carrying a disease. One of those tick-borne diseases, and there are many, as we'll see, one of them is Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Go ahead and get my thing working here. It is a bacterial disease, and the bacteria is a rickettsia bacteria. There are several varieties of the rickettsia bacteria, but this rickettsia rickettsii is the bacteria responsible for Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Symptoms associated with Rocky Mountain spotted fever infection or this bacterial infection: fever, headache, rash, vomiting, muscle pain, loss of appetite. If detected early enough, the prognosis is good. There's almost 100% recovery rate. Not quite 100%, there are fatalities. But if we detect it early, get it diagnosed properly early in the disease cycle, it does respond well to treatment. Patients with depressed immune systems are going to be more susceptible and more likely to suffer serious health problems or even death. And that certainly a lot of outdoor workers. I know in the construction industry, I worked with a lot of guys that, you know, they worked hard, but they also lived hard and they ate hard and they weren't in that good a shape and they weren't that healthy. They had high blood pressure problems, obesity problems, other health problems related to those two factors. And if they had developed Rocky Mountain spotted fever or Lyme disease or the alpha-gal allergy, it would be much more serious for them. And I'm going to talk more about the whole issue of comorbidities before we're finished with this unit. As far as transmission to humans, it's a tick bite. There's one tick specifically that carries this bacteria. Actually, three. I've got ahead of myself. The Rocky Mountain wood tick, the American dog tick, and the brown dog tick. But it's not all ticks. Certain ticks carry certain bacteria associated with certain diseases. So it's just not any tick's going to cause Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Not any tick is going to cause Lyme disease or result in the alpha-gal allergy. The alpha-gal allergy, I've already mentioned it once, that's kind of like the newest thing in tick-related diseases or tick-borne diseases. And we will talk a little bit about it before we're done here. And what we see in the picture here is a great example of why Rocky Mountain spotted fever is Rocky Mountain spotted fever. It develops this this outbreak of red spots all over the victim of the bacteria. And it is treatable, and it's successfully treated most of the time with the antibiotic doxycycline, which is also used with Lyme disease. Doxycycline is used as a preventative for Lyme disease. Now here is, you thought you might find this interesting. This is a timeline or a line graph showing the changes and the prevalence of Rocky Mountain spotted fever and the case fatality rate over an extended period of time, over a 100-year period. This graph goes from 1920 to 2020. And we have two lines on here. The red line is the case rate, the cases per million members of the population. It has increased since about 2000. We've seen a tremendous jump in the increase, in an increased number of cases of Rocky Mountain spotted fever since about 2000, and that's indicated by the red line here. But let's look at some specific numbers. In 1948, there were about 4 cases of Rocky Mountain spotted fever for every 1 million residents of the U.S. In 1960, it had dropped to 2 per million residents. 1980, 5 per million. 1992, it dropped back down to around 2 per million. And 2 per million, that's about the lowest it's been in this 100-year period. But let's see what happened since 1999-2000. In 2010, there are 27 cases of Rocky Mountain spotted fever for every million residents of the U.S., and which, again, increased prevalence. There are many more ticks than there used to be. I know I have a lot of family in western Oklahoma where it's really dry. And in the 70s, you hardly ever would see ticks in that part of the country. Ticks like the more humid climates, the moister climates. In the 70s, there weren't a lot out there. But you know, in recent years, you're seeing more and more ticks, even in those drier climate areas like western Oklahoma, New Mexico, and so on. But that's the case incident rate in the red line, which is interesting, the tremendous increase in the number of cases. But the blue line, which the red line, that's bad news. The blue line is the good news. Case fatality rates show us that the treatments are effective. The fatality rate is lower than it's ever been for Rocky Mountain spotted fever. In 1945, believe it or not, 28% of the cases of Rocky Mountain spotted fever were fatal. They didn't know how to treat it. I wouldn't say it was an undiscovered disease, but it was an understudied disease in 1945. 28% of the cases were fatal. In 1973, 10% of cases were fatal. And that's about the time period that my brother developed Rocky Mountain spotted fever in the early 70s. It may not have been 1973, but it was right around there. And he survived. At that time, about 10% of cases were fatal. In 2015, less than 1% of cases were fatal in 2015, which improvements in medical technology and our understanding of the disease and our understanding of how to treat the disease. So even though we have more cases, I won't say it's easier to treat the disease, but we know how to treat the disease, and it's there's still a likelihood of fatality, but it's a lot less likely than it has been in our past. If you develop Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever, you're probably going to survive. I mean, you could still die, but you're probably going to survive. The trick is getting it diagnosed properly. I don't have the literature here. I would need to do some more research, but I would bet that in a lot of the fatality cases, it's left undiagnosed until the person's dead. The autopsy determines that they had Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever, and they didn't know it. Nobody in the family knew it. So detecting, and that's true for a lot of diseases, detecting it early, getting it diagnosed properly. A lot of these tick-borne diseases, like Lyme disease or the alpha-gal allergy, they're incorrectly diagnosed. And when they're incorrectly diagnosed, the treatment is not correct, and the problem persists and can become more serious over time. So early diagnosis, correct diagnosis, very important contribution to this low fatality rate that we see in recent years. Now, breaking it down by state, we can kind of see the regions of the country where Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever is more prevalent. Now, this is 2020 data. It hasn't changed that much since 2020. But the South and the Southern Midwest, or the Southern Plains states, with the exception of Texas. Texas has a relatively low rate compared to, say, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Nebraska. New Mexico, Colorado, low rate. Utah, you get out west in the drier climates. Now, even though Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever, well, the Rocky Mountain states, the rates are lower. That's just a name that's been attached to this disease, Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be more prevalent in the Rocky Mountain states. Now, there is another tick-borne disease called Colorado tick fever that's different than Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever. Now, Colorado tick fever, that's going to be more prevalent in Colorado. Let's see, anything else I can say about this map? I mean, we're right in the heart of tick country. If you end up working for a company with outdoor workers, you need to make sure they understand the hazards of ticks. And we'll talk more about that as we move along here. Lyme disease, another tick-borne disease, a different bacteria. Borrelia burgdorferi, or burgdorferi, however you want to pronounce it. Borrelia burgdorferi is the bacteria that's responsible for Lyme disease. Now, Lyme disease in this map is real interesting. It's concentrated in the Northeast. This map here is from 2018. Now, we have slowly seen Lyme disease move west and south, but it's still found at higher concentrations in the Northeast. And there's a conspiracy theory as to why it's in the Northeast, but I don't believe the conspiracy theory. And I'll mention the conspiracy theory just for fun here in a second. But again, it's not because of what the conspiracy theory claims, but it is concentrated in the Northeast. Some of the symptoms are very similar to what you have with Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever. You have the fever, headache, rash, vomiting, muscle pain, loss of appetite. If left untreated, it can affect the joints, the heart, and the central nervous system. That's where it gets serious, when it's left untreated, just like with Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever. Transmission to humans, the black-legged tick is the specific tick that is responsible for Lyme disease. Prevention, insect repellent, good housekeeping around the workplace, remove ticks as soon as possible if a worker is bitten by a tick. And we're going to talk more about that prevention here in a second. We'll talk about tick bite prevention in general, which again may seem like a really commonsensical, why are we talking about this? Well, we're talking about this because of the thousands of cases each year, and there are workers that that develop these diseases because they're bitten by a tick, because they didn't know any better. They didn't know how to deal with it. And as safety managers, even the stuff that seems simple or commonsensical, we got to cover it. We got to dot our I's and cross our T's on everything. Now, here's the conspiracy I mentioned. But again, don't believe this. I'm not saying this is true. But the conspiracy theory on Lyme disease. Notice there's New Jersey right here. Right there, kind of the epicenter of all those blue dots. The conspiracy theory says that it was a government, it was a virus that was developed in a, not a virus, I'm sorry, a bacteria that was developed in a government laboratory using ticks as the research subjects. And some of those ticks got loose. Some of those ticks escaped the laboratory, from the laboratory, and that's why we have Lyme disease in the far northeastern United States. Again, that's pretty far-fetched. But what, you know, we do have Lyme disease. The only thing I can say for sure is that we do, Lyme disease is a real thing, and it is concentrated in the Northeast. But there are treatments. These are some of the different antibiotic combinations that are used with adults and children. And you don't have to know any of this. You don't have to memorize any of this. But I put this up here to reassure you that there are antibiotics available if the disease is diagnosed early enough and diagnosed correctly. But speaking of antibiotics, and yeah, most of you are probably aware of this, but just in case you're not, antibiotic drugs work for bacterial infections. They don't work on viruses. There are some antivirals that are being developed, but viral diseases have been much more difficult to treat because the antibiotics that work well with bacterial infections do not work well with viral infections. And that has a lot to do with the parasitic nature of viruses. Now, again, there are in development different antivirals. With the COVID virus, there have been some breakthrough medications for treating coronavirus infections. So there are antiviral medications, but antibiotics usually work best with bacterial infections. And here's a list of some of the other tick-borne diseases. Anaplasmosis, babesiosis, Borrelia miyamotoi disease, Colorado tick fever, Ehrlichiosis, Heartland and Bourbon virus diseases, Powassan virus, tick-borne relapsing fever, tularemia, we talked about that earlier. Tularemia is considered a tick-borne disease because it can be transmitted by ticks. Then the newest discovery on the list here is the alpha-gal allergy, or the red meat allergy. Alpha-gal is a sugar molecule that triggers an allergic reaction in some humans after those humans consume red meat. Still learning a lot about this condition. It's only been on the radar now 5 or 6 years, maybe 7. Trying to think. A friend of the family developed the allergy. I want to say 5, 6 years ago, so it was probably around before then, 7, 8 years. It's relatively new on the list of tick-borne maladies that are out there. And it can be serious. This allergy can have fatal consequences depending on the sensitivity of the victim to the allergen, to the reaction. There can be convulsions, there can be respiratory distress, there can be fatalities as a result of this allergic reaction. The good news that we seem to be getting on the alpha-gal allergy is that it's not permanent. If you are bitten by a tick, you develop this allergy, it looks like that that it eventually goes away. That 3-4 years, the person can get back to living a normal life and eat red meat. When I say red meat, I'm talking about pretty much a cow, pig, or a sheep, or lamb. Fish, okay. Chicken, okay. But anything that's not fish or chicken or seafood or poultry could trigger an allergic reaction, which I'm sure ranchers hate this allergy, but what can they do? It's come along. It's come down the road, and we're dealing with it now. As far as treatments, I don't know of any treatments that have been developed. It's so new. But the good news is it does. The patients do seem to outgrow or it does seem to go away after a period of time. Takeaway here, don't take ticks for granted. If you are working for a company where workers are outdoors, you need to have at least annual training on tick prevention, tick bite prevention. That'd be construction, oil field, landscaping. Just, you know, we all are exposed to ticks. We have, if we have a yard with grass, we need to be careful about ticks, especially here in eastern Oklahoma where there are a lot of ticks. And in Oklahoma, anybody spending any time outside will probably end up with a tick bite at some point in their life. I get 2 or 3 every summer, and I use the repellent. I just can't go an entire summer without one tick. And back when I was working in the construction industry with Oklahoma companies, it was, you'd get a new guy out on the job site. And this was early in my career before I learned to really preach the importance of insect repellents. But you'd get a new guy on a job site. They had some brush to clear. You know, it was an overgrown area. They might get 20 or 30 ticks off of them at the end of one day. So most ticks are not going to result in the disease. I've never been, even though I get bit 2 or 3 times a year, I've never been diagnosed with a tick-borne disease. But I'd rather avoid the bite and avoid and reduce that risk even further of developing a tick-borne disease. And that should be our goal with our workers. You know, let's try to manage it so they don't get bit, which lowers their risk of developing these diseases. And here, tick bite prevention, a lot of it, again, is commonsensical. Insect repellents, and you could even go old school with powdered sulfur. That used to be a tick repellent back in the day, back in the 40s and 50s, before we had DEET and some of the modern insect repellent. I wasn't around the 40s and 50s, but I did work for a farmer who was around in the 40s and 50s. And when we went out to build fence or whatever we were doing, he would always make us powder up our jeans with sulfur. He kept a big bag of sulfur, and our blue jeans turned yellow because of that sulfur. And it worked. Never got a tick bite with that sulfur on our legs. Now, we didn't put it anywhere but on our legs. And it worked really well. And this might be an option for some workers who are allergic to modern repellents. There are some workers who are allergic to DEET, and it can cause an allergic reaction in them that can be serious. If you have pets in the house, this is not work-related necessarily, but treat the pets. A lot of times they'll hop off of a pet onto you. Good housekeeping, mowing in the work area around your home can help prevent can reduce the tick population, which would reduce the likelihood of being bitten. Being awareness of the dangers of ticks. Every spring I would have meetings with the guys and, you know, we're in tick season. Check yourself throughout the workday. You know, let's not leave them on you any longer than they have to be there. Shower and tick check in the evening was also something that I taught. Wash their clothing when they get home as soon as possible. If you're not able to wash your clothing through the entire wash-dry cycle, you can just run it in the dryer for a few minutes. The dryer will take care of the ticks that may be in your clothing. We want to remove ticks as soon as possible, taking care to remove all tick parts. If we have a tick that's deeply embedded, or it appears infected, I would recommend medical care. I'm not going to deal with that as a safety manager. The worker shows me this tick here, that red area around the tick bite, and that tick is really buried in there. I'm probably going to err on the side of caution and have them visit a clinic for first aid treatment. If all the doctor does is remove that tick, that would be first aid treatment. Probably what's going to happen though, the doctor will remove the tick, but they're also going to want to give that worker a shot of antibiotics. The shot of antibiotics would make it a recordable injury. So, but I don't care about recordable injuries. I care about doing what's right for the worker and getting them the best care possible. And that's early on in the life cycle of this bite. That bite that we see here in the picture, it's going to get a lot worse, more than likely. All right, that's it for ticks. Let me know if you have any questions. In the next video, we'll talk about some more stuff.